Hello, this is Jim Calhoun. I am a licensed school psychologist here in Vermont. And just in response to some of the major changes that we have experienced in our community, in our state, and I don't think it's under misstatement to say that a lot of these changes have been experienced by the educational community as well, I began to think in terms of an old model that I have used and seem to go back to very often in terms of trying to understand both the individual and factors related to how people do in life and in education, and the context with which they love, live, learn, all the above. And that's Yuri Bronfenbrenner model of ecological development. So I'd like to share that with you if I can. So this is a model that, as I've said, I found particularly helpful in providing a frame of reference for understanding bigger picture applications, both for the individual and for context. So you see that in the middle, there's that individual. In this case, the individual that I'm going to be talking about is our student. Various age, various gender, and they are the center of this model. On the outside, the very close concentric circle is the microsystem. That's the families. That's us as educators. Those are the play groups and the health services and the church groups, the peers, and you'll notice that most of our students, most of us, have been cut off from these microsystems. We may have family, we have school at a distance, not having a lot of peer interactions, not having a lot of neighborhood playtime, not having church meetings, certainly not going to health services unless it's related to the current pandemic. The next outer circle, concentric circle, is a mesosystem, and that is really how variables, institutions or agencies within the microsystem interact, collaborate, coexist to support the individual. So how the family in the school is doing at this point, how physicians are doing collaborating with families at this point, the support you may be getting indirectly from your neighborhood, these are all part of the mesosystem. And our talk today is going to be the direct connection between family and school. Outside of the mesosystem is getting a little bit more distant to the individual, but the exosystem and the macrosystem is are those aspects of media and our culture. They how they influence, and we certainly have had some changes in terms of culture that has been brought about by the dramatic changes that we've all had to go through quarantine and restriction in terms of our access to shopping or transportation, even social events. One of the things that I think has been weighing on me or has been in the forefront of my thinking is this idea of the chronosystem. We are really at a socio-historical time that is changing the landscape in education. And we have an opportunity, I think, to build on this change and to shape it in a way that could be to the betterment of education. Some of the things that I'm thinking about is looking at this model in terms of its relevance to the individual, our points of focus in terms of our education, expectations, and how we collaborate across settings to encourage or increase engagement in learning. So recently, I was listening to another YouTube video by Christy Mraz, and she was talking about the work of Stuart Brown and his work on play personalities. And I found these really helpful to think about in terms of our current landscape and our current attempts to meet individuals as part of that micro and meso system in working together to build engagement, to increase engagement. We have some kids, some families that have not been as engaged for various reasons. And I found it compelling to think about whether or not play might be a way for us to provide inroads to access. So Christy was talking about different play personalities, including the Joker, the creator, the director, excuse me, the storyteller, the explorer, the competitor, the collector, and the kinesthete. That doesn't quite roll off the tongue, but I know what she's talking about. So what we have the opportunity to do is to really look at how kids are spending this time away from school, away from friends, participating with families. Are they playing in these models? Are they following these types of personality profiles in their play themes? And it could be a way for us to build more collaboration with parents in our attempts to build an understanding about these play themes. Is my child or is my student more of a creator? Are they playing? Are they directing the play? Are they exploring? Are they collecting? These could be the basis of establishing flexible pathways in terms of getting assignments done or creating different assignments that will increase the likelihood of engagement, both on a behavioral level, but also on a cognitive and emotional level. Something that the individual student, the child, will be motivated by, be self-directed at, will have some interest in pursuing, and not just doing it to get it done because adults are asking them and there's some kind of a requirement. We have some kids that they will not respond to that. They're not as interested in pleasing adults, and they are much more interested in seeking their own source of entertainment and interest. So moving our expectations to kind of tap into those is one way of potentially increasing engagement. So I ran into this in the initial parts of our school dismissal, in that we have a number of kids that were participating, but we had another group of kids that we weren't hearing much from. And I'm thinking of one particular individual who was not participating in any of the socially motivated morning meetings, and was certainly also not participating in any of the academic requirements, whether they be the synchronous instruction or any assignments that could have been completed and handed in remotely. So reached out to those parents, and between school personnel and parents, really talked about what are the things that this student is engaging on a preferred basis. What are they choosing to participate in? And it came to pass that this individual was very much a collector, was walking a lot, was picking up different specimens from nature, keeping them in a notebook. And so what we thought was, we will take that and have her, encourage her to catalog those objects that she found, to write about them, just a description of their, you know, physical form. And then maybe if she was interested in doing some research to find out what is the, what's the source of this material, what's the source of this object, what is it used for, what could it be used for, where did it come from? So just to give some dynamics. So if she found a feather, to research what kind of a bird it came from, some individual characteristics of that bird, and then to be able to share that information in that, that journal and with her teacher. Now, in some cases, you will already have this information as a teacher who's known these students for quite some time now this year. And so you may have some idea about whether or not they fit into one or more of the play personalities. In other cases, this is an opportunity for parents and teachers to collaborate on building a case for, in the here and now, in this current landscape, what are they doing? And where might that fit in terms of those categories of play personality? And then building some assignments that are either directly related to things that you're doing in the classroom, virtual classroom, or some more independent studies, more flexible pathways for younger kids. Now, this can be done, as I said, from younger kids right up until middle school. It can be done for older students as well. We tend to have a little bit more in terms of flexible pathways for middle school and up. So what I'm really focusing on now is pre-K, kindergarten, through around fifth or sixth grade. So whether or not it's the classroom teacher who makes the contact with parents, or it's the homeroom teacher, or it's the TA teacher, someone who is building a bridge of communication to have a discussion with parents about what is the current state of that individual's play, of their inquiry. It's also will give us an opportunity for those individuals who are not even going to participate at that level, finding out whether or not these kids are playing. What are they playing? Might not lead to either a additional work being done on class-related assignments or independent studies, flexible pathways. But we would get better insight, more insight into the what they're doing, what they're engaged in on an independent level, and being able to communicate with the parents that there's so much value that is derived from play is in and of itself. And I think, you know, Christy Mraz talked about this, and it's important to keep in mind, you know, people like Jack Schoenkopf on through Dr. Bruce Perry have been talking about the benefits of play for much longer, much before this current pandemic has changed the landscape. So suffice it to say, play is valuable. There's learning to be had in play. And rather than trying to build the stress and build anxiety of some parents and some children who at this point are not ready to engage in something other than what they're doing, that they're struggling on if we want to look at Maslow's hierarchy, they are on some of the more basic needs, getting those need met as a priority. So we're able to say, this is sufficient in terms of their education. They're playing, they're engaging with other activities, they're having fun, they're staying safe, being healthy, and they're learning through that. play is really an opportunity for us to work on all the scholarly habits that we've worked on throughout the school year. And this is another, I think, important aspect to think through. This is an opportunity, not just of flexible pathways. There is an opportunity right now in this current landscape to really focus on scholarly habits. Whether it be play, whether it be the academic work that we are assigning, whether it be an individual flexible pathway in terms of gathering materials on in their vicinity, in their natural vicinity. I'm working a lot with kids on games, building in games in Minecraft, or creating worlds and collaborating, being in on the same world where you have, that's your only limitation, your only option for social contact. So we are engaging indirectly through these games and playing by collecting, or playing by exploring, or playing by directing your storytelling. So all those are evidenced in these games that we're playing. But we're also working on scholarly habits. We're working on perseverance. We're working on problem solving. We're working on shifting our cognitive set and flexibility. If something doesn't work out the right way the first time, what are my options for seeing that through? These are really, as I said, foundational skills that are critical, regardless of whether or not we're talking about an academic content area or a personal play area, personal interest area. And it's an opportunity, as I said, for us to really reinforce the work that is being done by kids. And actually, to be honest, with us as educators and parents, this is new ground for us. We have had to shift our mindset in terms of our own worldviews and our problem-solving ability. So in essence, every one of us has been working on scholarly habits. So this gives us an opportunity in our discussions with parents to talk about specific ways that kids have been working on these areas of problem solving and perseverance, and somehow trying to showcase those and reinforce and acknowledge them in our reviews of grades and performance over that time, over this time period. So those are the things that I've been kind of thinking about more recently, and hopefully they are helpful to you or conjure up some additional questions, things that to think about or talk about with colleagues, and to be able to meet kids where they are, meet families where they are, and make some adjustments to our system to use this crisis as an opportunity to make some modifications in our work, but also as a system. So I thank you for listening, and stay safe.